Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Albaugh, along with our producers Aaron Zommers and Jeff Perry. It is Thursday, June 8th, 2023. That is 608 day. Eighth day of the 6 month, 608. Also the area code for much of South Central and Southwest Wisconsin. 608 day. We're celebrating that here on the show. Call in. Love to hear from you. What is your favorite city, activity, or place in the 608? Give us a ring. 844-967-2789. Again, 844-967-2789. Or make it easy on you. 844-96-PARTY. That's P-A-R-T-Y. Appreciate Wausau Mayor Kate Rosenberg in hour number one. Coming up in this hour, at the bottom of the hour, a great interview. Sat down yesterday with State Senator Kelda Roys from right here in the 608. She represents the 26th Senate District, encompassing most of Madison, including the University of Wisconsin-Madison. She's a member of the Joint Committee on Finance, better known as JFC, the Budget Writing Committee, known in political circles as the most powerful committee in the Capitol. She is one of four Democrats on the committee, controlled overwhelmingly by Republicans, the majority party, as it always is. The majority party has complete control on JFC. She's trying to get more money for issues like things like child care, special education funding in public schools, and also for the campus right here in Madison, the engineering school, which has raised $150 million plus in private money, with the expectation that the state would kick in at least that much to build this much-needed engineering college building. There's a wait list of 8,000 students every year. Talk about a job creator. Talk about an economic driver. And Republicans manipulated the system. First of all, they made sure that the building commission, chaired by Governor Evers, could not do it. So they sent it to JFC. Then they stripped it out of the budget in JFC. Also, the Richland campus down in Southwest Wisconsin, my alma mater, now part of Platteville and the restructuring. System President, UW System President Jay Rothman, over the Thanksgiving Day massacre, he cut the head off of the Richland campus turkey. Said he was closing it down, suspending academic programs. Never visited Richland Center, did Jay Rothman. Never went to the UW-Richland campus to check out things for himself. Never sent any of his minions to the Richland campus before he made the decision. Then interim chancellor Tammy Ivetovich didn't want to go and talk to people. They made the decision anyway and closed the campus down due to enrollment, as they said. What they didn't tell you is how the campus had been set up for failure by both system politicians on the Republican side and inept leadership in Platteville. Probably cost $2 to $3 million to help save that campus. About, coincidentally, the same number that JFC approved for the Packers for the NFL draft. We asked Senator Roys what she thought about that and whether Democrats would be willing to help save the Richland campus. Howard Marklein represents that area, co-chair of the JFC, might want to stay around for the interview. Tony Kurtz might want to stay around for that interview. Jay Rothman and his minions on the 17th floor of Van Nuys might want to stay around for that interview. Very interesting response from Senator Roys coming up at 2:30. Looking forward to that. Also going to talk a little bit at this hour about what's happening with the Trumpster and Trumpster world. Justice Department has informed Donald Trump he is the target of classified documents probe, according to several sources. Is a criminal indictment of Trump on the horizon? And what do you think about that? Is this the one that's going to stick? And are any of the Republican primary voters going to care? I don't think so. Well, maybe some. I think it's only going to embolden the 30, 35% that are already with him. Give us a call, 844-967-2789. That's 844-967-2789. Taking your phone calls until the bottom of the hour when we welcome in State Senator Kelda Roys on the program. And it's Frank Lloyd Wright's birthday. Great tweet sent out by our friends at the Minota Terrace Convention Center. It is the 156th birthday of Frank Lloyd Wright. And they tweet out, on this special day, we celebrate our famous architect's life and a remarkable legacy and invite you to learn more about the experience and magic of his design. Truly a gifted guy. Frank Lloyd Wright, you can go to MinotaTerrace.com to learn more. Also go to Taliesin in Spring Green. And Jeff and I's hometown of Richland Center, you can go to the Frank Lloyd Wright Museum. Oh, wait, there isn't one. But I bet you could go. I bet the Warehouse Museum is open today. The last existing structure that Frank Lloyd Wright designed in Richland Center. It's a cool place. Now in a private conservatorship, basically. Stop by and see it. Help donate. Save that place. A great place in Richland Center. That's one of my favorite places in the 608. What is one of yours? Give us a call. 844-967-2789. That's 844-967-2789. We will take your calls and we will figure out exactly what your favorite spot is. We'll ask Mr. Perry, Mr. Zomers as well. Take your phone calls and more. And Kelda Roys at the bottom of the hour. Stay with us. Don't go anywhere. This is the Todd Allball Show. And this is the Civic Media Radio Network. Fun doing it. It's the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network, along with Mr. Jeff Perry and Mr. Aaron Zomers. Welcome back into the program. Quarter after the hour now, welcoming your phone calls, 844-967-2789. That's 844-967-2789. Make it easy, 844-96-PARTY. P-A-R-T-Y. Breaking across the news wires at this hour, and you're not going to believe this. I'm going to quote a Fox News source. This Chad Pergram, who is the senior congressional correspondent at Fox News. Yes. Yes, that's true. Chad Pergram at Fox News tweeting out this. Source is familiar with this FBI document reviewed by the Oversight Committee in Congress. You know, the Republicans have been going after Biden, saying that the FBI has a document that shows that Joe Biden took illegal payments, and they were gonna subpoena the FBI. They wanted to see this document. They were gonna make it public. Well, now Fox News' Chad Pergram reporting, quote, sources familiar with the FBI document reviewed by Oversight Committee members today tells Fox the following, quote, to be clear, the document does not say Joe Biden received any payments, unquote. Let me say that again, that quote. To be clear, the document does not say Joe Biden received any payments, unquote.
Oh, sure, a left-winger like you would say that. Right. Oh, wait, it was Fox News.
It was Fox News, it turns out. And as No Lie with Brian Tyler Cohen said, and just like that, Republican narrative has collapsed. Just like a souffle out of an oven on a December afternoon, the Republican narrative against Joe Biden has collapsed. Imagine that. Imagine that. So very interesting. Before we turn to the 608 a little bit, I want to update you on this story regarding Trump. U.S. Justice Department has informed Donald Trump's legal team that he is a target in a federal investigation into the possible mishandling of classified documents, according to several sources, CBS among them. The sources have been informed of the target letter and its contents, but have not seen it themselves. Prosecutors' decision to inform Trump he's a target crystallizes that special counsel Jack Smith's investigation is, in fact, focused on the Trumpster's actions and not just the actions of people around him. That's an important decipher. It's not just the people around him. It's actually on Trump. Trump's legal team met with DOJ officials, including Smith, about the investigation on Monday. The meeting focused on the Trump legal team presenting their allegations of misconduct by prosecutors. Smith did not say anything beyond greeting those in the room in the meeting, according to sources. The Justice Department regulation allows for prosecutors to notify subjects of an investigation that they have become a target. It's often an indication that a person is a target, is a strong sign an indictment could, keyword, could follow. But it is possible the recipient is not ultimately charged. Going to be interesting to find out what Matt Flynn says about this next hour. I'm sure he's going to touch on this. Matt Flynn, an attorney, of course. And he says, you know, the old saying goes to the legal profession, you could indict a ham sandwich. I mean, it's that easy a lot of times. But this one's different than the one in New York. This is criminal, not civil. I mean, this is much more serious. So it's going to be very, and the way that they did it, apparently, is the charges that they're potentially going to indict him on isn't going to involve whether or not he declassified the documents, but rather whether he shared documents that he shouldn't have. Very cagey, the U.S. Department of Justice, and how they're, what exact charges they're indicting Trump on. So you don't have to have this, you know, debate about, well, I declassified them in my head. They're taking that off the table, apparently, according to these reports. And going to say, it's not about whether you declassify them, sir. It's about the fact that you took them and you had them when you should not have, classified or not. That appears to be where the U.S. Department of Justice is going. We'll see about that. Also, Mark Meadows, former chief of staff to Trump, reports now that he has flipped, or at least partly, and is seeking a deal with the Department of Justice to testify in exchange for leniency on his own charges. Also a very significant development as well. It is 20 minutes past the hour of 1 o'clock. As we've been saying, it is 608 day, a celebration of all things in the 608 area code. I said one of my favorite things is the Warehouse Museum in Richland Center. Cool place. Mr. Perry, what are your favorite things in the 608?
The first thing that comes to mind is American Players Theater in Spring Green.
Of course it is, because that's what you know. That's where Frank Lloyd Wright went. No, it's a great. Go ahead.
Yeah, I love it. Was introduced to it by my English teacher in high school, Mrs. Majeski.
Oh,
and,
Mrs. Majeski.
And we've been going there with the pandemic notwithstanding. We've been going there every year since, and it's just a wonderful place. You can see Shakespeare. They do other plays as well by other playwrights. Right. And it's just an amazing experience. The theater, you know, literally in the middle of the woods. Mm-hmm. You walk up the hill and get to the theater, and they have an indoor theater and things on the grounds now. It's really expanded.
Yeah.
But that's a wonderful place to see a show, and it's just one of my favorite places.
And a cool little community as well. Absolutely. Easy to see why Frank Lloyd Wright spent time there. Spring Green, right on the banks of the Wisconsin River. Just a beautiful place. Mr. Zomerins, what say you, your favorite place in the 608? Before you do that, give the phone number out again. If you'd like to call in and give a shout out to your favorite spot, your favorite store, your favorite business, your favorite thing to do in the 608, give us a ring. 844-967-2789. That's 844-967-2789. Mr. Zomerins.
Well, first of all, I'm going to have to go to a show at that theater. That sounds pretty cool.
Oh, it is. It's fantastic.
But all that aside, 9 out of 10 listeners agree. Number 7 on this list will shock you. No, what I mean by that is no one at all is going to be surprised when I say that my favorite feature of the 608 is all the really good game stores.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. There are a couple of game stores in and around Manitowoc, but nothing
not in the 608.
Nothing like what they have here in Madison and the surrounding area. There are so many more. They're so much bigger. The communities are huge. And I've done some research to see, yes, it's bigger. So, of course, there's going to be more bigger than Manitowoc. But even disproportionately compared to other larger cities, the gaming, board gaming community in Madison is incredible and well-known. There's a lot of board game conventions that happen around here, and people come from all over the country just because the community is so fun.
Right. No, that's a great another great example. I guess a couple of my runners up would be our one of our news stations now in the Civic Media Radio family up in La Crosse, WLCX 1490 AM, The Eagle, up in La Crosse. Love going to La Crosse and driving up. Never hiked it, but drive up on the top of Granddad's Bluff. Great view on the Mississippi River. If you've never been to La Crosse and gone to Granddad's Bluff, take a drive up there and check it out.
Also, Devil's Lake. If you've never gone hiking around that, it's beautiful and feels like you're in Lord of the Rings almost with some of the views there.
Some
of
like example. Yeah.
Climbing up the different rocks. It's beautiful.
Yeah, absolutely. So Devil's Lake, which is near Baraboo, just north of, or actually just south of Baraboo, I think, in the Baraboo Bluffs, Devil's Lake, great state park. I see our state park systems. But yeah, over in La Crosse, happy to be on the air over there on the Eagle, 1490 AM WLCX. Great to be back in La Crosse and check out Granddad's Bluff, or as Mr. Sommer said, another great outdoor area in Devil's Lake down by the Baraboo area in southwest Wisconsin. Friends of mine who know me will know on any given day, I love to relax at the Memorial Union Terrace right on the lake at UW-Madison's campus. One of my dreams was to go there and never had the academic ability to do so. So I live vicariously through my two godsons, Alex and Jason, who are now proud alums of UW-Madison. Jason, a proud alum of the engineering school, mechanical engineering with aerospace. Would have been nice if they'd maybe have a brand new building there for the engineering school. In fact, he picked my graduation gift to him for both Alex and Jason. I said, pick out the plaque, you know, that your diploma goes in. Do it all by. That'll be your graduation gift. I did it for both of them. And so Jason picked out the one that has the picture of the current engineering hall on it. He said, I want this one because they're going to make a brand new one, and I want the one that was there when I went to school here. So he got that one. Well, unless something dramatic happens, that's still going to be there for a while, Jace, because Republicans stripped this out of the budget. Anyway, sorry, I didn't mean to go by high horse there. But Memorial Union Terrace at right on the banks of Lake Mendota. Great place on the sunburst chairs to have a brat and a beverage. A great time. And, of course, it brings up, of course, Monroe, Wisconsin, down in Greene County in the 608. One of my other favorite small towns in Wisconsin. Cheese Days, unfortunately not this year, but Cheese Days will be happening next year. And I'm going to tell you, Mr. Perry, we are going to have a Richland Center reunion down there in, we're going to be broadcasting live from the square in Monroe next fall in September 2024 for Cheese Days. We'll invite all the Richland Centerites down there. And Mr. Wheat will be hosting us, I believe.
Outstanding.
he's saying right now, that's news to me. Yeah, he'll probably be out of town. He'll be conveniently out of town during Cheese Days next year. We shall see. What is your favorite spot in the 608? Give us a call, 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789 as we celebrate all things 608. When you take a look at like the top 20 counties in the 608, of course, Dane County, Rock counties like Janesville, that area is in the 608. La Crosse County, as we said, home of the Eagle over there, 1490 AM. Then you got Sauk County, to Mr. Zomer's point, Devil's Lake, Baraboo, Sauk City, Prairie du Sac, all that area. Then you've got Grant County, where Jeff and I also finished up our college education at UW-Platteville. Platteville. Mixed emotions now about Platteville, right? With the campus and Richland Center closing. Anyway, then you've got after Grant County, Monroe County, home of the Black Squirrel Festival in Wilton. Did you know that? Did you guys ever been to the Black Squirrel Festival? It's a real thing. When I was running for assembly the first time in 2004, Wilton was in the 96th Assembly District. I did the Black Squirrel Festival Parade. And let me tell you, there are actually more black squirrels there than other places.
That's not a drink, is it?
That's a pink squirrel.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
Wouldn't that be fantastic if there were actually pink squirrels? Now I'm sounding like Will Ferrell's Harry Carey. Wouldn't it be fantastic if there are pink squirrels? And maybe after a few pink squirrels, you would actually see pink squirrels. I'm not sure. That's a possible. Greene County, my beloved Greene County, also in the 608. Columbia County, Vernon County, home of Wonder State Coffee, which I have a little in my cup here. We're going to come back. We're going to talk to Senator Kelda Roys from here in the 608 in Madison. A great interview. We recorded it yesterday. Not going to want to miss it. We're going to make a little news. Stay tuned. This is the Todd Allball Show. And this is the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is 6:08 day, June 6th, or pardon me, June 8th. Get the right order there. 6:08, Todd, on this beautiful June day. And how appropriate on 6:08 day is we have a state senator who represents the heart of the 6:08 here in the Madison area. That is Senator, State Senator Kelda Roys. Senator, thank you so much for joining us on 6:08 day.
Happy to be here. It's always 6:08 day for me.
Right, exactly. And for those listening around the state, Senator Roys represents kind of the heart of the Isthmus, the University of Wisconsin-Madison campus, and kind of points out towards Middleton and that area, some of the suburbs, but really the heart of Madison. Exciting district to represent.
Yeah, I feel so lucky. This is a district where people are really engaged. They pay attention to what's happening in state politics. They hold me accountable, so I have a huge number of constituent contacts, and it's wonderful. You hear from, you know, on every issue you can imagine, I hear from folks.
One of the most important roles statewide that you have is being one of the four Democratic members of the Joint Committee on Finance, better known as JFC. For those who don't know and haven't been involved in state politics and budgeting, JFC is known as the most powerful committee in the state legislature because that's where the budget goes through. That's where all the money decisions get made. Of course, there it's overwhelmingly controlled by majority party, which happens to be Republicans. But you, along with your three colleagues on the Democratic side, have been fighting for several issues that, Senator, if we could talk about a couple of them, because what stunned me as a former Republican, a former Capitol staffer on the Senate side, is many of the things that Democratic Governor Tony Evers and your colleagues on the Democratic side have been proposing and fighting for are issues that are pretty popular broadly and shouldn't be partisan. And one of those is child care industry and funding for that and family and medical leave, and yet Republicans have stripped that out.
Yeah, that was very disappointing because everyone, wherever you are in Wisconsin, if you want to have a thriving community, you need to make sure that you have childcare available. We're not gonna have workers. We're not gonna have an economy that functions well if we don't have childcare. It's just not an economic reality for most families, if there are two parents in that family, to have one stay home full time just to have kids. I know so many people that would love to have more than one kid, but they are limiting their family size, or they're not having kids, or they're delaying having kids because they can't afford childcare or there aren't spots available. 70% of people who live in rural Wisconsin already live in a childcare desert, and about half the state overall is a childcare desert. So we put $340 million of funding into a program to help sustain and stabilize the childcare industry. And if Republicans continue to zero fund that, if they basically eliminate that program, we're going to see the closure of about 25% of the slots of childcare in the whole state.
And again, Senator, this is an issue that is, it's not partisan. I mean, as it turns out, right, both Republicans and Democrats have babies. So, you know, it's odd, but that's what
we all love our kids. And we all want our kids to have great, safe childcare so that, right, we can support them and go to work.
I mean, I know there are people out there, there are couples out there who are getting pregnant, and they're putting themselves or their child on a wait list for childcare either as soon as they know they're pregnant or in some cases even before they become pregnant just to try to have a chance at having childcare. I mean, when we have a $7 billion surplus in this state, it seems like we can take part of that to help alleviate that problem.
That's right. I mean, this has been a problem for a long time. We have, the childcare industry has needed more support because it is just not capable of functioning as a purely profit-driven enterprise. I'll tell you a story that you might appreciate. When I first got elected to the state assembly in 2009, I was not yet married. I was actually engaged. Mm-hmm. And a staffer came up to me and said, hey, I don't know, you said, Representative Roys, but if you're thinking about having kids, you should get on the waiting list right now at Creative Learning. And I was like, who is this guy? That just, you know, I was like, you're the young legislator. Let me just see if they're going to have kids. But you know what? That was actually probably the best advice I ever got from any staffer in the Capitol. Because I did get myself on the waiting list. And that is the only reason that I was able to have infant child care when I eventually had a baby 3 years later.
That's amazing. That is amazing. Yeah,
so it's wild. And of course, it's gotten much worse, you know, in those 9 years since.
I just don't understand it. You're not here to defend the Republican agenda by any means. I'm just curious, what when you and your Democratic colleagues on JFC bring this up, what's the Republican response to you?
Well, you know, you get some lip service. Representative Bourne said, yeah, we know child care is an important issue. Some of them obviously just don't support it. They're like, if you have kids, you should take care of them yourself, period. Or, you know, only the wealthy should get to have kids, I guess. Is the other reason.
What fascinates.
But, you know, privately, I think a lot of them do understand. You know, I've had senators say, like, wait, how much do you pay for, because I have three kids, how much do you pay for child care? And it's like, how do you do that on a legislator's salary?
Right. And I think that I agree with you. I think a lot of them do understand it. And it's just purely partisan. It's because a Democratic governor proposed this and they don't want to give the other side a quote unquote win. And so they oppose it. And the sad part is it's the citizens of Wisconsin who end up being the victims here.
It's really sad because once these childcare slots are gone, once these centers close, it is almost impossible to see how you're going to be able to restart that, right? This isn't just something where you can turn it on, turn it off, you know, open a new Starbucks or something. Childcare is, you know, people have to be able to rely on it. And once people are out of the workforce, it's hard for them to get back in. So if you step back, even voluntarily from the workforce, because you want to take time with your kids and you can afford it, it's hard to get back in. So this is going to devastate an entire generation of young workers, and it's going to make Wisconsin even less attractive for people who are thinking of starting a family, for the young workers that we need to keep and attract to help our state thrive.
Another issue that's closely attached to this in terms of funding for childcare is family and medical leave. Of course, the governor put that in his budget. And the funny thing is that the Republican nominee for governor last year, Tim Michaels, said he supported it. Also, in a weird, you know, a politics makes strange bedfellows moment, a far-right Republican Right to Life organization also supported it because they said, hey, you know what, if we're going to be consistent, we're going to oppose a choice and healthy access for women's health care, maybe we should actually care about kids once they're born. And they supported this. And yet your colleagues on the Republican side of the aisle and JFC stripped it out. And then when your colleague Evan Goyke had the audacity to point this out, Howard Marklein, the state senator from my area of the state and the co-chair of Joint Finance, shut his mic off.
Yeah, it was very disappointing. But it shows you how the Republican legislators do not actually want to hear how unpopular their ideas are. They don't even want discussion of things that they disagree with because they understand that it's bad press for them.
Right.
They seem, they're going to be less popular if people know what they're actually doing. And, you know, you can talk to any small business owner out there. I'm one. We had a roundtable of small business owners. They all said they are desperate for this because they can't compete. They can't retain employees. They can't take the risk to start a business themselves if we don't make this a public program. Just like we have workers' comp and unemployment insurance and Social Security, we know how to do this. This isn't rocket science. This isn't some, you know, complicated new thing. We know how to help people after they've just had a baby to have that time off to bond and to recover from birth. And it's crazy that we're not doing it.
And to your point, I spent 25 years plus in the Republican Party before I left in 2011 over voter rights. I hear time and time again, job creators, jobs, the economy. This is a, if you want
to. And family values.
Right. And family values. I mean, if you just want to be cold about it, let's just call it, this is helping jobs. So I don't get it. Let's move on, if we can, to the public school system, special education. And I think there's a lot of folks out across this state, no matter what part of the state they're listening to us in. You know, sometimes we think about the severe and profound, but there are a lot of kids who are not severe and profound that qualify for special education, and school districts across the state are struggling to fund that in the public school system. We had Matt DeFore on earlier this week from Wisconsin Watch. They've done a great investigative piece in this, looking at every single school district and figuring out that local school districts are having to make up the shortage which state funding isn't providing them. And that comes from local taxpayers. Again, Senator Royce, we have a $7 billion surplus in the state of taxpayer money. Don't we think there should be a little bit of consideration here to fix this issue?
There certainly should be. Schools are mandated by federal law to provide education to all kids, including kids with special needs. And that is, of course, as it should be. Problem is, the state does not pay the cost. And sometimes the cost can be significant, right? They need special supports. They need additional aids in the classroom. You know, whatever we need to do to mobilize it so that every kid has the freedom to learn and have a great public education. So when those are not covered by the states, then local governments, local school districts have to make up the cost. And that, you know, that means less money for everyone. That means that they're going to then have to cut other things that every kid deserves, like music or sports or foreign language or any of the other things that make school a wonderful place for kids. So this is a terrible, short-sighted decision. We actually pay almost all the cost for kids who need special needs when they go to a voucher school, a private school, and yet we don't do that for our own public schools. And I think that is outrageous, and it's a shame, and we need to remedy that. And that's what Governor Evers' budget has proposed to do.
And on that issue in the Wisconsin Watch piece, what they were looking at is families with kids with special needs wanted to do open enrollment, change school districts, and the new district said, we'd love to take your kid. We don't have a teacher. We don't have the facilities. A, they don't have the funds. And also, Senator Royce, after Act 10 in this state, if you even have the funds, can you even find a teacher to hire?
That's right. Right. I mean, part of the problem is that we have been underinvesting in our public education system for decades, right? It has been easy to say, oh, trim a little here, trim a little there. And then Act 10 happened. And at a certain point, there's just no slack in the system, right? You can't take more kids. Or we've got all this money that should have been going to public schools that's been going to vouchers, you know, something like $450+ million every single year out of our public schools and into voucher schools. So, you know, at a certain point, 2 + 2 = 4. And if you take away 2, you don't have 4 anymore. And that's what our schools are facing. And now is the perfect time, because we have this massive surplus finally, to reinvest in our public schools. So every kid gets the education they are constitutionally entitled to.
It's not just K-12. Let's move to higher ed. We have just about 3 minutes left. I'm sorry, the time always goes so fast. Love having you here. You represent UW Madison. One of the number one project of UW system that they wanted in this budget was the new facility for the engineering school at UW Madison. Talk about job creation. My understanding is my godson just graduated from the engineering school. There are 8,000 students on the wait list. Talk about job creation,
yeah,
and Republicans cut it out.
Exceptional, because they, you know, it's harder to get into that engineering school than almost any higher educational institution. You know, we are one of the top programs in the world, and we have so much more need than we have the capacity to serve. We could be building probably 5 engineering buildings and still have people wanting to come to UW. Our employers need this. You know, engineering is one of the best paying, most stable, and most growth career opportunities. We have to be serving young people in Wisconsin and giving them an opportunity to study engineering here so that we don't lose them, you know, to Purdue and to Duke and to all these other places that they can go. It's crazy and short-sighted, and it happened because Robin Voss cares more about punishing UW-Madison for voting Democratic than he does about the future of the state.
100% agree. I know you can't speak for your other three colleagues, but quickly, on the UW-Richland campus closing in Richland Center, do you believe mm-hmm. that you and your three Democratic colleagues would entertain $2 to $3 million in funding to help save that campus if Howard Marklein and Tony Kurtz said yes?
Absolutely. I think it's a terrible tragedy to think about closing campuses at a time when we need to make education more available and more accessible to every Wisconsin community.
I think we just made a little bit of news there, Senator. Senator Kelda Roys, we appreciate you so very much representing the 16th Senate District in Madison in South Central Wisconsin. Come back soon, Senator. Thanks for your time.
Happy to. Thanks.
Senator Kelda Roys back with more after this on the Todd Hallball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome back to the Todd Hallball Show, the Civic Media Radio Network. It is now 10 minutes before the hour of 3 o'clock. That is 10 minutes before the start of Matt Flynn Direct. You're not going to want to miss it. I bet you a dollar to a dozen donuts that Matt's going to talk about the things going on out in the Supreme Court, as he likes to call them, the nine tarantulas. The Supreme Court doing the right thing, finally. Justice John Roberts joins Justice Brett Kavanaugh in voting with the liberals in saying that Alabama has to redraw their lines down there. You cannot have a packed district predominantly made up of black voters. All this and more from Matt Flynn Direct coming up directly after the news at the top of the hour. How about that? Thank you to State Senator Kelda Roys for coming on the show. When I asked her whether or not she thought that she and her three Democratic colleagues on the Joint Finance Committee would vote $2 to $3 million to help save the Richland campus, she said unequivocally, quote unquote, absolutely. You see that, Howie? You see that, Tony Kurtz? You see that, President Jay Rothman and the six-figured employees on the 17th floor of Van Nuys Hall in Madison? You see how easy that is to work across the aisle? We've got four votes from the Democrats to save the Richland campus on joint finance. You add in Marklein and Kurtz. All Howard Marklein has to do is get two more votes. It would be unprecedented for the sitting chair of the Joint Finance Committee not to be able to get two more votes from his own caucus to save a campus in his own district.
But you know what he'd have to do to get those votes?
What's that?
He'd have to ask for them.
Right. Come on, Tony. Come on, Howard. Do the right thing. Use your 999. We'll explain that tomorrow. Use your 99 motion to save the Richland campus. The Democrats are there to help you. Let's go to the phones, 844-967-2789. Go to Mark in the sack. Mark, what say you?
Well, I think it would be wonderful if we could save. I mean, we've got a $7 billion surplus sitting in and tucked away, and we'd certainly be able to save the Richland, the campus there. But the other thing that got me, listening to the voucher schools, that I wouldn't be so angry about the voucher schools if they were required to meet the same standards as the rest of the schools in the state of Wisconsin, meet their performance standards, because they are not.
Right.
And that's what really gets me. It is that it's all the parents can decide. Well, no, but then the parents, that they should have to meet the same. If they're getting this funding from the state of Wisconsin, the state of Wisconsin should require them to meet the same standards as they require the other schools to make. Because rather than dumping on the public schools all the time, of which I am a proud result of, the good mm-hmm. education I received up there in Superior, Wisconsin, that public education all the way through it, including at UW Superior there.
Yep.
That, I mean, it is just disgusting to me that they can use the public schools as a whipping boy and say that, they're failing when they want to underfund them. They want to depress the staff. They want to depress the administration in the various communities. And it is disgusting. I mean, it is just absolutely disgusting.
Great article in Wisconsin Watch online. Go to Wisconsin Watch. Great articles on this very thing, Mark, on using public funding to finance voucher schools and then not going along with doing things like protecting kids with LGBT kids and other things along that line. I'm all for it. I mean, if you want to be a private school and only use private money, that's one thing. But if you're going to accept public money, then you got to play by the rules. rules. And I was a public school kid as well. Mark, always appreciate you calling in. Have a great day out there in the SAC. Thank you so much. To Mike in Sheboygan. Mike, what say you?
Comment on the 608 for someone who knows Europe probably better than the back end of the 608. But I have to say, it's always amazing to me what I see out there in the backcountry. Also on Wisconsin Public Television, Wisconsin Foodie, the incredible hidden gems. I'm always amazed what the 608 has in terms of humanity and culture. And now whenever someone calls from down there, I always think of nice people. Not only the pollinator front lawns that don't need to be mowed anymore. I know, Todd, you're a fan of that. I just like to get a dig in on our Republican friends who constantly violate the Ninth Amendment about bearing false witness as they slam Milwaukee, Madison and Dane County. As well as the Eighth Commandment, thou shalt not steal. I think that if they looked at what we spend on expanding I-94 and I-43 every couple of years and ripping out a bridge we just put in.
Yeah.
What we spend on Foxconn, what we spend on the Gableman investigation, what we spend on defending the fake electors, what we spend on any of these shenanigans, not to even include the $7, $8 billion in surplus, daily interest. I think there'd be enough left over right there to easily pay for Richland Center and also have them including, maybe they want to consider golden-plated toilets in their gender bathrooms.
Great point. Appreciate you calling in, Mike. I think you make the great point that there is so much out there that you can take the surplus, you could make cuts from these Republican programs, and you could fund real things like the campus at Richland Center or other programs. I mean, this is the point.
It costs the community, it costs them a lot more to shut it down than to keep it going and an investment in the community. The knockoff effect, secondary, tertiary, across the entire 608 area is much larger than the saving on tuition they don't spend on a couple of students.
Well, your point.
It's a shame.
Well, appreciate you calling in, Mike. Thank you very much. Really appreciate you calling in, Mike and Sheboygan. And this is a great point that Mike makes. This is a statewide issue. What they did at Richland, this is coming to your campus all across the state of Wisconsin unless people speak up to your local elected officials and say, we're not going to take it. I mean, Jay Rothman, the president of the system, has already put out the edict that the two-year colleges, heck, the entire system, they now have to justify their existence to him. And you know what that's a precursor of? Because I spent a few years at the state capitol. Anytime someone asks you to justify yourself, it means if you can't meet their standards, you're gone. And this closing of the two-year campus at Richland Center, this could come to Sheboygan, could come to Manitowoc, could come to Marathon County, could come to Barron County, could come to Waukesha. Everybody in this state needs to be aware of what happened at UW-Richland and was about to happen unless Howard Marklein and Tony Kurtz grow a pair and join with Kelda Roys and the other three Democrats, who they are now on the record, Kelda Roys is saying that Democrats would quote-unquote absolutely vote and support a motion by Howard Marklein and Tony Kurtz to save the campus at Richland Center. We're talking $2 to $3 million. Just the caller just pointed out the excess money we're wasting. Need to do more for Wisconsin. There's a $7 billion surplus. And time we start investing in education across this state. Stay tuned. Matt Flynn Direct is next. Not going to want to miss it. Headlines, history being made. Matt Flynn will take you to the front lines of history in about 7 minutes after the news. Don't go anywhere. Mr. Perry, Mr. Zommers. Also, a special shout out to Senator Kelda Roys and also Mayor Katie Rosenberg for being great guests today. All the callers as well. Also, a shout out to the family and friends of Juan Jose Lopez here in Madison, a great activist for so many years. Juan Jose Lopez passing away yesterday. Our thoughts are with them. Whatever you believe in, don't give up. Matt Flynn is next. This is the Todd Allball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network.